two. Very good, you guys. All right, now we're going to focus on the adductors, okay? So these are our inner thigh muscles. So let's go ahead and spread them out just like this, all right? So this is what we're going to do. We're going to practice bringing one hand to opposite sides, okay? So we're going to raise our hands up to your comfort level, and we're either going to go to the opposite knee or the opposite foot, okay? So you're going to rotate and go down. Back, rotate, and go down, okay? If you want a little bit more flexibility, a little bit more movement, this is what you guys can do. Once you go up and you drop your knee, you drop your hip, you can drop your knee, just like that, to work even more on the hip, right? That's a good way to loosen up the hips. If you sit down or stand up all day long, this is a good way to get blood flow there, okay? So we'll go for another 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2. All right, guys, that is our time. Great job, guys. Now, we're going to climb up again. We're going to focus on the torso, our core, okay? We're going to do a twist and a half, okay? So we're going to use our armrest if we have it. If not, it's okay. We're going to have both hands together, and we're going to grab the armrest or maybe the chair, and we're going to look back and get a quick stretch. Hold it for a second. Right, you might hear a pop or two, and then you're going to turn and look back again. All right? Turn. Loosen up, hold it for a second, and turn, okay? Pay attention to your breathing. Go at your pace. We'll go for 10 more seconds. 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2. All right, guys. Now, we're going to move on. Now, we're going to focus on the sides, okay? We're going to go ahead, and we're going to practice doing a side bend and a half. So, we're going to pick one hand up, and we're going to come in and then do a double dip, just like that. Bring the hand over and do a double dip, right? A nice stretch for your back and your sides, just like that. Okay, we'll go for 10 more seconds. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2. Perfect, guys. Good job to you guys. Now, guys, I like to do a lot of stretches that focus on big muscle groups, okay? So now we're going to try to do a stretch that all the way from your neck to your forearm, okay? This is what we're going to do. We're going to put our right hand out like this, like we have a tray. And we're going to reach as far as we can, right? Make sure we're holding the tray so our hands should be like this. Now we're going to bring it back as much as you can and down. Now bend your head the opposite way. Okay, opposite ear to the opposite shoulder. Now you should feel a stretch that stretches the nerve, right? Relaxes it, especially if you type a lot. This is a good one for you. So we'll go for 10 seconds. 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2. Let's relax, right? Same exact thing. Again, pretend like you're holding your tray out. You're going to reach with your arm as much as you can. You're going to bring it back, bring it down, and you're going to bend your head to the opposite shoulder, right? This is a good one if you type a lot or if you grip a lot or if you have rounded shoulders, right? So we'll do it for 5 more seconds for this. 5, 4, 3, 2. Good job, guys. I have one more for you guys to finish. We're just going to do some simple head rolls, okay? So we'll go head rolls in one direction, drawing a circle with our nose, just like that. Very good. Do it carefully, slowly. Let's go the opposite way. Okay, we'll go for 5 more seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2. All right, guys, there you have it. Thank you all so much for doing this with me and Revamp Fit. I look forward to doing this every town hall meeting with you guys. I hope this got you guys feeling a little bit looser again, you can do all these movements at any point of the day, right? Very easy. All you need to do is just make sure you're safe, right? If you're doing it seated, you just need a chair. If you're not, you can do it standing. So again, thank you guys for having me, and I'll see you guys next time. Bye, everybody.
Thank you so much, Abel. We appreciate it always. And I think this is a great way to kick us off tonight, especially since we'll be talking a lot about wellness and creating a new normal. This has become sort of a part of our new normal at URU, you know, as a part of our town halls, and it's something that our team looks forward to every week. So with that, I would like to offer a really, really big warm welcome to everyone who's here with us, whether you're with us via Zoom or if you're with us on one of our online streaming platforms. We're excited to have you with us this evening. We will be taking questions, so if you have questions, please feel free to pop them in the chat, or if you're remote, put them in the comments and we'll do our best to get back to you. So to start us off, we are going to launch our first poll. And if you could please fill out the poll while I introduce our wonderful guests, that would be great. So if our tech team could launch our first poll, please. And I will introduce our guests that we have with us this evening. So tonight we have with us Dr. Lisa Upshaw. Dr. Lisa Upshaw is an acupuncturist whose intention is not just to help alleviate symptoms, but to show others how they can become their own best healer. By learning to pay attention to the body's signals and approaching wellness care from a mind-body-spirit perspective, she believes that true transformational wellness can be attained. She received her BA in psychology from Xavier University in 2000 and studied at Southern California University of Health Sciences from 2001 to 2004, where she received her doctoral degree in chiropractic medicine and a master's in acupuncture and Chinese medicine. In 2006, she founded Well Body Innovations, where she helps her patients set and achieve their holistic wellness goals. Working with acupuncture, whole food nutrition, herbs, stress management, and chakra balancing, she utilizes a multifaceted strategy to improve health. As a practicing holistic medicine doctor and a former lecturer at Loyola Marymount University, her mission has been and continues to be to educate and empower others to feel their absolute best. Dr. Upshaw, we are so happy to have you with us this evening. Welcome.
Thank you so much for that warm welcome. I am honored to be here with you guys.
And our next guest that we have this evening is a returner by popular demand, Dr. Camille Jones. Dr. Jones is an epidemiologist and public health expert. She served as Assistant Health Commissioner and Division Director for the Community Health and Environmental Health Services Division of Cincinnati Health Department. And during her tenure of over 12 years, she and her award-winning staff and partners made Cincinnati a much healthier city through a broad range of creative efforts and initiatives. She is the developer of the award-winning Creating Healthy Communities Coalition, which collaborates with numerous community partners to promote healthy and active living. Dr. Camille Jones earned her MD from Case Western Reserve University School of Medicine and her Master's of Public Health from Johns Hopkins University. Dr. Jones, thank you so much for being with us this evening.
Thank you.
So to start us off, we will do what we usually do, a little COVID-19 update. A lot of things have been happening in the last couple of weeks. So Dr. Jones, would you be able to sort of give us a brief overview of what you believe people should know about boosters, how to stay safe during the summer, and things like long hauler symptoms. These are things that have been coming up a lot in our town halls, and I think it's always great to have a little refresher and see where things are at the moment.
Okay. Well, the first thing is there are no boosters available yet, but there is a lot of talk about the possibility of needing boosters because the level of antibodies that people have may decrease over time. And at a certain point, it may decrease to the point where you need to sort of bump it up again. When people hear about boosters, you know, sometimes people say, well, if you're going to need a booster, let me wait and get the booster. But that's not sort of what you want to do. You want to get vaccinated now, get that level of immunity up. And then if you have to sort of nudge it a little bit in the future, that's what the boosters would help do. Mm-hmm. In terms of staying safe during the summer, I mean, one of the big things that has happened is the CDC's announcement that mm-hmm. fully vaccinated people don't have to wear masks when meeting with other fully vaccinated people indoors. And a lot of people have taken this to mean that the pandemic is over, which is wrong. Okay, the first thing is that in the US as a whole, only 2 out of 5 people are fully vaccinated. And so, you know, everybody's not vaccinated. But people have been taking this to mean I can take off my mask, I can just go do whatever I want to do. And I think that that's setting us up for some difficult times in the future. It's premature. I've gone into, you know, I know I'm in Cincinnati, and in Cincinnati, we are at about 40% fully vaccinated. And I go in the grocery store and nobody's wearing a mask. And I'm like, it's just giving me the willies, because I know that, you know, in that particular store, everybody is not vaccinated. So it's sort of a real problem. The other reason it's a real problem is that, you know, you've heard about variants, you know, the COVID variants coming through. And basically what it means is that the more that the virus gets into people and it replicates, you know, I mean, it makes you sick, but it has a chance to mutate. And some of those mutations can make it even more easy to spread person to person, or it may make it likely to give more severe disease. And there are currently 4 what they call variants of concern circulating in the US. And you've heard them, you know, you're not supposed to address them as by country names, but most people know them by country names. And so you have the UK variant, which is B117, the South Africa variant, which is B1351, the Brazil variant, which is P1, and now the India variant, which is B1617. And these variants are circulating. So far, it looks like the vaccines are holding against these variants. But if you only have 40% of your population vaccinated, you know, these variants can run wild through the unvaccinated population. And so the things that you would want to do to stay safe during the summer would be, 1, rush and get vaccinated. That's the first thing. But if you are hesitant about getting vaccinated, talk to your doctor about it to get the best up-to-date information. And if you're absolutely against getting vaccinated, you had better be doubling up on the precautions that you're taking, because these variants that are circulating are becoming the predominant way that people are getting COVID, you know, in the various countries, including the US. And, you know, you actually need more protection, not less, during the summer to say stay safe. But really, get vaccinated. That's the real message. Do you want me to hit long haul?
Sure. If you'd like to touch on long hauler symptoms, that would be great. I know one that has been one of the issues that's been of interest in the town halls in the past has been the impact on the cardiovascular system and kind of some of these long-term effects that we'll see in long haulers and in people that might not have the symptoms anymore, but these things that are still sticking with people even after being sick.
Yes. Okay, so the first thing I want to do is to say that some people are like, well, you know, most people are not going to die. Most people are not even going to get hospitalized, you know, and so I'm just going to sort of stick it out. But what people don't realize is that 1/3 of people who get COVID infection, even mild cases, can have persistence of symptoms over time and may even develop new symptoms over time. And these include the things that you might expect, the cough and the shortness of breath, but also fatigue, muscle pain, chills, fever, brain fog, inflammation of the heart muscle, an increased tendency to clot, you know, to form blood clots. And so, you know, you form blood clot in the heart arteries and you have a heart attack, form a blood clot in your legs, you may flip that clot to your lungs and have a pulmonary embolus. You know, you have a lot of different symptoms, and these symptoms last and last and last. Some people have had these symptoms for 8 months and counting. And is the sort of thing where it's actually a source of disability in people, many of whom were previously healthy, that, you know, they didn't expect, and, you know, that's sort of hard to treat.
Thank you. Yeah, I think it's definitely very important to think about all of those different components, you know, that these things that can happen in the long term. And it's also important, one thing we've discussed in other town halls, is, you know, what can we do now to, you know, besides getting vaccinated, and these other precautions that we're taking, how can we take care of our health? So I think thinking about how can we manage symptoms and how can we take care of our health, not just now when we're nervous or when we're scared of these things happening, but in the long term as well. So with that, Dr. Lisa Upshaw, I would love to sort of get your input on ways that holistic medicine and practice may be able to help people stay on top of their health before something might happen. And also, you know, some of these symptoms that Dr. Jones talked about, like muscle pain and, you know, the achiness, what are some different things or ways that, you know, holistic medicine, that approach can be taken to help with some of those symptoms?
Well, absolutely. It's been very interesting working during this time, because I have certain patients who have amped up their wellness and have taken the time to exercise and eat right and get enough sleep, and have really been terrified of being vulnerable and have really taken it upon themselves to be the healthiest ever. Now, with that has also come some work-life balance, because as people are sitting at home, they're also finding that they are sort of prisoner to their Zoom meetings, and they're staying on between, you know, 12 and 14 hours a day with little breaks. And so I think during this time, it's been really important to consider balance, and holistic wellness is all about mind, body, and spirit, and not just focusing so much on, you know, cardiovascular exercise and eating right, but then also making sure that there's a conversation about you know, limits and free time that you're spending, and how you can do it in a very safe, you know, safe way that doesn't make you vulnerable to catching the virus. But on the other hand, I've had people that have been really depressed and have, you know, felt almost guilty for not taking advantage of the time and not eating better. And so they've, you know, become, you know, addicted to substances, and, you know, whether it's food or alcohol or other drugs. And they have been a little embarrassed about it, because, you know, you have one extreme and then you have the other, where it's like, gosh, am I making it worse now for, you know, me to have worse and pre-existing conditions that can make me, you know, possibly experience COVID if they were to get it in a much more, you know, serious way. So I think what I always come to is it's important to understand your body and understand how your body talks to you when you are stressed out, when you are emotional, and when something is wrong. So I've had patients come in recently that are having new symptoms. And, you know, I always say, well, what is your baseline? What is what you know to be true about your body? And I think that's my biggest suggestion in general, is understanding how your body speaks to you, understanding your body language now and taking it through forever. Because if you were to get a symptom of some sort, you kind of have to know and say, okay, I am feeling a little bit more tired than I think I should. And is it because I stayed up all night? Is it because maybe I was at a party and I wasn't as safe? Is it because I'm having a side effect of something? So my desire has been for more people to deepen their understanding of what it means to be healthy mind, body, and spirit now, so that we can just become a more functional society going forward, a society that's more in tune with balance in general.
And I'd like to add to that. There have been actually studies showing that there's been like 41% of people during the pandemic, when asked, were saying, yes, I'm depressed, yes, I'm anxious, you know, and this is a much higher percentage then would have answered that way in 2019. We also have a lot of people who have struggled very hard to stay safe during the pandemic. And there's the expectation that as people start loosening up, that people who are just, you know, I gotta make it. If they feel like it's loosening up, then you're gonna have more expression of things like post-traumatic stress disorder or the depression or other things, because people feel like now, you know, there's a chance that they can do it. They don't have to hold on so tight. So what you have to worry about is, are there enough, treatments or people aware of that, looking for that, for these people who are all gonna be having issues coming up in the next few months because they have been tamping down, you know, the grief and the fear and all of those things during the past year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's a really important point. In one of our other town halls, we discussed medical distancing, and I think it's really important to point out, you know, that's not just going to the doctor for a medical condition, that can also be addressing your mental health, you know, like you mentioned, Dr. Jones. So thank you. So Dr. Upshaw, you talked a little bit about holistic wellness, but I want to kind of go back a little bit because I don't know if everyone on the Zoom is super familiar with the term. So if you could kind of talk to us a little bit about what it is, what are some of the benefits? And you talked about kind of creating this baseline as a way to get started. So if you could talk a little bit more about, you know, how might someone approach holistic wellness if that's something that they're interested in?
Absolutely. One of my favorite questions, because essentially all holistic wellness is thinking about how our ancestors most likely lived. We live in a very fast-paced modern society now that is very much driven by capitalism. You know, it's very much driven by production. And so we're often looking to see the fruits of our labor. And that comes at the expense of, as I was mentioning, mental well-being, spiritual well-being, emotional well-being. And by no means do I consider myself a mental health specialist, but what I see in my practice often is that the body is always going to tell you how you really feel. And when you ask yourself, or when someone asks the question, you know, how are you? You know, it's an automatic response to say, I'm fine, I'm doing okay, you know? But what I always say is ask your body, what is your body telling you? Have you been having headaches? Have you been feeling any like chest flutterings? Has your stomach been in knots? Are your bowel movements off? That is what can set you up for having a deeper conversation with what the reality of your life really is. So when I mentioned sort of like ancestral living, I say that because often, you know, people fellowshipped. You know, it wasn't just about the singular individual that was doing everything on their own. We came together, we worked together, we collaborated. I know Dr. Jones, it was mentioned that you do a lot of community work, and that's where our wellness really stems from, is the collective. So a part of holistic health is being able to know that you can reach out. Even though we've been isolated, we still have all found ways to connect via Zoom or via, you know, FaceTimes and things like that. And that's a key essential component to making sure that we stay healthy. We also had group spiritual practices. Whether it or not you have a religious practice that you grew up with or something you've discovered later in life, I do think it's important to connect with a higher power so that you know that you are not alone in all that you do. Often we pray when we don't know where else to turn. That's a part of health and wellness. It's just knowing that the burden is not all yours to carry. That also falls onto the lap of the community. Emotional well-being and mental, you know, well-being, as Dr. Jones mentioned, that many people are experiencing depressive episodes more now than ever. And I have had people that have come in to see me, and upon talking about what they're experiencing, they're like, you know what, after talking through it, I think I'm depressed. And, you know, sometimes it just takes somebody listening to you to like, and then for you to hear yourself say it. And then for them to say, you know, I think I'm going to, you know, go on, you know, this listserv and find a therapist, or do you have any referrals? You know, Dr. Lisa Upshaw, you know, can you point me in the right direction? Because I think if I don't get this piece together, I don't see myself feeling better. So holistic health is essentially mind, body, spirit. And with that mind, we can go mental and emotional. And knowing that they are all equally important to stay healthy and well.
I love that you mentioned also community wellness, you know, and realizing that not everything falls just to you. You know, when you're talking about turning to a higher power or also turning to your community. And I just want to quickly acknowledge we have with us this evening Allah from Black Lives Matter New Haven. And so I want to give a shout out to Allah and also to open the floor to her to let us know about your the organization and the resources that they have to share. Because like you said, Dr. Upshaw, you know, community is so important and Black lives, they matter, you know, and it's important to find community with people that you can really feel with and understand with, and think and live and breathe with. So Allah, I think you're here somewhere, right?
Yes, I'm here.
All right. So could you let us know a little bit about Black Lives Matter New Haven?
Well, firstly, I would just really, really like to give an appreciation for Camille and Dr. Upshaw, you folks. I've been on mute and video mute, like, yes, thank you. Me too. I've been saying that. And so that was actually a really amazing segue, Carmen, because so some of the work that, you know, our chapter focuses on community care first. That's that was some of the first work that we started doing in 2015, working with the community, folks without homes, folks who are struggling to get resources, folks who have tried to tap into some of the community resources that we're told are supposed to help, help us, but you know, so much is left out, right? Like you'll walk in like, oh, I'm gonna go get help. And sometimes you walk out like worse, feeling worse than what you walked in on. And oftentimes for me, before I started organizing, those are often the points of where I disengaged from the community and disengaged from those resources, so much so that I ended up into homelessness twice and like all of those things. So the work that we do at what Black Lives Matter New Haven is we move very intersectionally. We started working very microly when it came to New Haven and Connecticut and really tapping in and working with the community. So right now we're doing, every year we have a couple of community drives right now, coming up really soon. The beginning of May 5th is our next community hygiene drive. And I'll just give you a snapshot of what that looks like. Oh, wait, hold on. How do we do this? Okay, cool. So those big bags, that right there is our house's version. Our house's number, because we broke them all up. We have five of us. So all five of us are packing 100 to 150 bags each. And what we have in there are the things that you need to stay COVID safe. Hand sanitizers, masks. You never have too many masks. We really market this for folks without homes, folks who are economically challenged, who are coming through the downtown area. And I mean, it goes without saying that most likely if you live in New Haven, you are economically challenged. And then if you add on the intersections of queerness or Black or brownness or Latinxness, right? Like then you have a double, triple, quadruple chance of that intersection really sitting in poverty and sitting in the results of what capitalism and overproduction look like. And so what we try to do at Black Lives Matter in New Haven is in building with community, realizing that community has saved our lives. So that's why Dr. Upshaw, when you were saying, I was in the kitchen going, yes, I was just saying that the other day, like the reason why I'm here is because of my community. And we really try to pay that forward. We do book bag drives, we do hat, coat and glove drives. And now that like thinking about, right, like, you know, our town hall and it's the new, what's the new normal? Hopefully we don't go back to the old normal and we keep this framework and outlook that I would have said only would have existed in Octavia Butler novels before COVID. And since COVID started, I said, we're living in an Octavia Butler novel. So I'm just waiting for my superpowers to kick in. You know what I mean? Like, you don't even know. I got the vaccine hoping. I'm like, listen, maybe it's the boosters that'll like, let me get this, like my last, you know, power up of Black liberation. But that's the work that we do. We work, we build our community connection first. And that has grown into 2021. I'm the president of C10, which is a lobbyist, a grassroots lobbyist collective that started and staffed, not paid staff, but almost soon, staffed by the grassroots organizations throughout Connecticut. We are working directly in policy change and galvanizing our legislators, as well as making sure that we give out 600 to 700 hygiene bags, reusable bags that folks can use. We have toothbrushes, we have shaving cream, shaving kits, hand sanitizer, hand wipes, toothpaste, mouthwash, deodorant, chapsticks. Everything that everyone needs to live. I could use some chapstick right now myself. So that's what our work looks like. It's the reason why I joined in with URU. It was, we did not have a background. We didn't have the ability to start this mass COVID education and town halls and getting connected to the vaccines and the clinics that we knew were going to be coming. But our work with BLM is making sure that one of us is connected to the work on the ground. Like Sun is doing transformational justice right now, so that way we can make sure that we not only facilitate it, but we use art and the things that are connected most ancestrally to Black and Brown and Indigenous folks. And like folks who have become white, right? Like as soon as they get the drums, they, you know, taps into their ancestors that are far removed from them as well. And so that's the work that we're doing. We're making sure we move constantly intersectionally and making sure we connect with our community, and they are the folks who are informing the work that we do.
And you guys are helping to build that new normal that we're talking about.
Yes. So yeah. Yes. Thank you so much. Mess up the system.
exactly. Thank you so much, Ella, and thank you so much to Black Lives Matter New Haven. You guys do awesome work, and we're always so happy to partner with you.
Yes, and also I'm just gonna give a shout out to you, Karma. Congratulations.
Oh, thank you so much.
You're welcome. Proud of you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
With that, we were talking about, you know, I think Ala gave us great examples of, you know, what building a new normal looks like. And so I would love to hear from Dr. Jones and Dr. Upshaw, you know, based on both of your backgrounds, you know, Ala mentioned there are some things maybe we don't want to go back to. And there are some things that we've started that are great that we want to keep. So how can people start thinking about and reimagining, you know, a new normal, whether that be for their community, you know, for themselves, for their families? What insights do you have to offer? Dr. Jones, do you wanna start us off?
I'll start off, but I may not have all of it. For myself, my new normal is I'm just gonna keep wearing this mask at least until next February. And the reason for that is that I think that people are taking it off too soon. I get the willies when I go indoors. I know that the COVID virus can be passed through aerosols indoors. And if you're indoors in poorly ventilated conditions, you're at higher risk. So I'm gonna keep my mask on. That's my new thing. For my family, you know, I may be the doom and gloomer, you know, but I'm basically warning people that we probably will have another surge. It may come mostly among the unvaccinated, but we know, and there was something in the chat about that even people who are vaccinated can get COVID. You know, you have much less of a chance of getting it. You're like 94% protected, but some people can. And especially people who have anything that may cause their immune system to be a little bit compromised. They, even if they get the vaccine, they may are still perhaps at more risk of COVID, though not as much risk as if I didn't get the vaccine. And so I'm telling people in my family to be ready for you know, perhaps another surge, to keep their defenses up for a while, you know, just till we can see what happens. And I'm making it till next February. In the community, you know, I can say that at least for like the healthcare community, there's a lot more community sort of how to say it, coordination. You know, so there had to be coordination between hospitals that were overwhelmed so that they could move patients to other hospitals that could take them. Coordination between, you know, EMS systems, you know, to pick people up. So I think the new normal in the community across the board is going to be the coordination, is going to be the, you know, using more of the digital platforms to connect and to exchange information, you know, that sort of thing. And also hopefully the new activism, which is coming out of people saying, wait, you know, these things are happening, they were bad before, and now the epidemic has exacerbated the ongoing disparities that we already knew were there, and that we need to have more activism to try to address it.
Dr. Upshaw?
Yes, and I wanted to just go back to one of the last questions you asked me, because I don't think I thoroughly answered it, and that was how to establish a new baseline. And really quick, I just wanna say, to do a body scan and take inventory of your whole body from head to toe and do that on a regular basis. I've had some patients in the past that have been so busy, they haven't even recognized pain. And then when I ask them on a scale of 0 to 10, what does such and such feel like? They're like, I've never thought about it. And then after a couple of weeks, they're like, oh my gosh, for the first time, I actually felt my neck. I just haven't tuned into it. And now I am. So take inventory of your body, do a body scan, check in with each body part and see how it's doing. And then look at the circumstances around yourself at that time to compare it throughout, you know, weeks in the month. In terms of going forward, what the new normal looks like, a couple things. One, I hope that we continue to look for the root cause and the root of the issue. I think a lot of the disparity that we're seeing, a lot of the imbalance that we're seeing, as we know, is a result of years of a poor functioning system, or a system that doesn't treat everybody fairly and equally. So we need to not just look at how to solve it in the moment, but how to solve it forever and get to the root of what's broken within all of the systems. So that's one. I hope that our new normal continues to propel us that way. The other is that I hope that we continue to care about each other. I think that a lot of us were concerned about how our grandmothers, our aunts, our cousins, our friends were doing during this time, and we were checking in a lot more often. Mm-hmm. I think we were concerned about like our even our immediate community. And so I hope that we continue to care about one another and not just think about self, but think about others. And I think with that comes prevention, and with that comes, you know, essentially wellness, you know, not waiting until something is wrong, but checking in, you know, when things maybe are a little bit askew, like, you know, I noticed you weren't your usual self. Can I help you? Do you need something? So I hope we continue to do that.
And I think for our last formal question, before we dig into some of the questions from the chat. I'll split this up into two questions, one for Dr. Jones and one for Dr. Upshaw. So how, Dr. Jones, would you advise people to sort of start this, have a vaccine conversation with someone today? And then for Dr. Upshaw, my question for you is, how would you advise someone to have like a wellness conversation with themselves and with other people that they care about? So I'll hand those off the way that I gave them. So Dr. Jones, as far as approaching, you know, the vaccine conversation, sometimes, you know, getting the vaccine, we've talked about all of the benefits there, and we can kind of almost think about that as a part of making sure that you stay well, you know, making sure that you do keep your wellness and in the long term. And so how would you say we could approach, because it's still, even, you know, a year plus in, it can still be difficult to have that conversation. So how would you recommend kind of approaching this?
I think that, you know, you have to, you know, one has to recognize and say, you know, people are adults and, you know, there are reasons that they either do or do not take action at a certain time, but that people can also get more information and maybe revise, you know, revise their thoughts or their actions based on the information they get. So really the thing is to provide people with information and to also hear what concerns or what worries they have. And so it can be done both at the family level, you know, like one person vaccinated and they can just sort of say, well, I want you to get vaccinated because I want you to be protected too. You know, what problems or what things are you concerned about? Talking to your doctor if you have one, or trying to find a healthcare provider to talk to say, well, you know, if there's some myths that are floating around and you just can't tell because you heard something on, you know, Facebook or something, you just can't tell, is this true or not? You know, to talk to somebody who is in a healthcare situation and whom you trust to give you the straight, you know, information about, is this true or is this not? And to do it repeatedly, because, you know, nobody wants to feel like they're being forced or pushed into anything. And really, you know, it's like a person does have to decide, but you just have to try to provide information or provide chances for them to say what's worrying them about it.
Definitely. Thank you. Dr. Upshaw?
You know, for me, it comes down to what I've observed over the years, and that's that people essentially just want to be seen. And whether it's having a conversation about vaccines and COVID or having a conversation about general wellness, if often we speak in general terms, it flies over people's heads. And I think what's important is really getting specific to individuals and what their unique needs and desires are in their life. And once you really find out what someone's personal wellness, personal life goals are, what they're missing, what they've missed in the last year, what they want to get back to, then you can kind of work your way into health and wellness, because essentially people really don't like to share their faults. It's like talking about religion or talking about money. People don't want to say, oh, you know, my blood sugar is way up, or my blood pressure is way up, or, you know, I'm depressed. You know, people aren't going to come right out and say that. So I think what it requires is really being in touch with your authentic self and connecting with the other person's desire to be seen for where they are, and taking the time to really, you know, check in and get to know them. So that's how I would approach a wellness conversation. How you can mirror that, mirror what you would like to see in your community, is to be honest, you know, be honest with your community about what you've struggled with and share that. Because I think people will feel like, okay, I'm not alone. You're going through this. Wow, I thought you really had it all together, you know? And then they're like, okay, well, let me share with you. I've really been, you know, having a hard time too. So, you know, let's just like dropping the facades and just being real.
I want to add something that also comes up with this for the vaccine conversation, which is, do you have access, or did you have to go through multiple hoops to try to get access to the vaccine? Did you give up? Is it somewhere near you? And that's sort of where public health is going now, is moving away from the mass vaccination centers where you have to come in, and trying to move vaccination access to various places in the community, even through like mobile vans or finding community organizations which will sponsor vaccine clinics. And so I think that having that access where, you know, the day you decide to get the vaccine, you actually can get the vaccine, that also will help.
Most definitely. I think we only have, we're a little bit over time. We have two quick questions in the chat if there's time. Do you have our doctors? I want to be respectful of your time. You guys have a few minutes. Mm-hmm. So someone asked, now that 12-year-olds can get the vaccine, how can parents feel comfortable as they give consent for their children? Because that is a big responsibility. And also, just from my own studies and research, that also tends to fall on mothers, not to discount the fathers out there, like y'all are still doing great supporting and making decisions, but so often healthcare decisions just statistically fall on the mother, you know? And so thinking about that, what can someone do, either mom or dad, grandma, caretaker, caregiver, whoever it is who's giving consent for this child, you know, how can they feel comfortable with that? Or how can they also sort of, I guess, from a knowledge standpoint, and then also from sort of like their own mental health standpoint and talking themselves down from perhaps getting overly anxious about making that decision?
COVID is not necessarily benign in kids. You know, there's some children who have died from COVID. There are some studies that show that even in like young athletes who get COVID and recover, if you actually look at their hearts, 1/3 of them have inflammation of the heart, the heart muscle, myocarditis. And you know, you have to look to see it, but we don't know what the effect of that's going to be long term for these kids. So COVID is not benign in kids, even if they have an initial mild case. We know that there are a lot of vaccine preventable diseases that kids do get vaccinations for, and it keeps them healthy. Things like measles, you know, which can, you know, people think, oh, I had a case of measles, but measles in some kids actually caused encephalitis or caused them to die. I think that the parent would have to say, you know, the vaccines, you know, the studies that they've done look like they're good. We already know that COVID can cause problems in kids. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to try to protect my child as best I can by getting them this vaccine to try to keep them from having long-term disability that may come from a COVID infection. Now, you know, I mean, you know, it's the sort of thing that you just have to sort of sit there and think through. But, you know, the vaccine preventable diseases, measles, polio, smallpox, you know, those sorts of things which were actually devastating children before. And now, you know, hardly anyone ever hears about it because most kids got the vaccination. I mean, that's sort of how I would approach it with the mom.
Thank you. And then I think I'm trying to make sure I get all the questions that were sent in the chat. Someone asked about categories of patients who potentially should not get the vaccine or who should, let me find this exact question. A class of patients who shouldn't get the vaccine or who might be more dangerous. I think they were specifically referring to someone who's immunocompromised. If you'd like to speak to that, Dr. Jones, at all?
Yeah. People who are immunocompromised should get the vaccination because immunocompromised means that you already have a lessened degree of ability to fight the virus off. You should get the vaccination, but you also have to know that the same thing that, you know, made your immune system not as active may make the vaccine not as effective. So it'll still be effective, but it may not be as effective. And so people who are immunocompromised get vaccinated, but also continue to follow the other public health precautions even after you're vaccinated. You know, like the things I mentioned, you know, going indoors in crowded spaces, you know, especially now, since everyone's going to have their masks off and you don't know who's vaccinated or not, you don't know what you're getting exposed to in those intense indoor situations. You know, wear your mask, wash your hands, keep your distance, even after you're vaccinated. And that would be even more important for if you're immunocompromised, but definitely get the vaccine. The only people who should not be getting the vaccine are people who are allergic to the components of the vaccine. And that's very few people.
Thank you. And I think our last question for Dr. Upshaw, I guess, so someone in direct messaged me and they said that they loved a lot of your advice on wellness. And do you have any other sort of go-to wellness techniques that you like to use that, you know, kind of anyone can use that are very accessible to incorporate into their everyday life?
Yes, you know, I hate to say it boils down to simplicity. Well, I will say I'm an acupuncturist by trade. So acupuncture is definitely one of my favorite wellness modalities. it's great because we address the body in a very natural sense. We don't use Western diagnoses. It's about excess and deficiency, and whatever is out of balance, we seek to find homeostasis. So that's one way that I like to treat myself and treat other people. So with that principle in mind, whatever else you can bring into your life that gets control of the excess and boosts the deficiency is what you want to do. That could be, I'm really big into fitness and exercise, whether that is yoga or just moving my body in some way. It can be meditation, going to bed, quieting my mind so that I'm not thinking. A lot of times I hear people have a hard time switching off at night, so they're up late and they're not getting proper rest. When you don't get enough rest, your body is depleted and your immune system is weakened. If you're, you know, producing all day long and you're sleeping for 3 hours, that's just not enough. Also, you know, I'm really big into functional nutrition and finding ways in your diet to make sure you are getting all of your basic nutrients, a good balance of protein, fat, and complex carbohydrates, and that you are mindful of the timing of the day that you're eating, not too close to bedtime, staying hydrated, drinking enough water. So those are just some like very basic general things, but the basic and general things often go missed. They don't happen with the majority of the population. So that's why I just stress those things. But of course, I'm a huge fan of acupuncture. Breath work is really big on the scene right now. Breath work now is like the yoga of the early 2000s, where everybody's talking about it in the alternative medicine scene. Essentially, it's just making sure you're getting deep breaths in. Anything that you're holding, that you're restricting, is then given some space to move out of the body. And one quick thing, in the work that I do, we always say that energy is neither created nor destroyed. So if there's something that is pent up in you, it will find a place to go in your body if you don't let it out. So you want to be mindful of not bottling up and holding on to the things and finding the appropriate channel for you to let it move.
Thank you so much. Those are all of the questions from our chat. Thank you so much to both of our wonderful guest speakers, Dr. Upshaw and Dr. Jones. It's been wonderful having you. Before everyone starts logging off, please take a couple of minutes to fill out the final poll. It should have just popped up for everyone. And I would also like to thank Abel, who has been with us every week for these town halls. He does an amazing job. I don't know if he's still here, but I just want to say thank you to him. And of course, also to our whole team who, you know, they work in the background to make these town halls happen. Our tech team, Meredith, Ruth, Molly, Andres, Pastor Victor, Lourdes. We have so many great people, Jason Campbell. We have so many people, great people working behind the scenes. I know that for the last few weeks, you guys have been seeing mostly my face and our guest doctors, but there's a lot of people that make this happen. And so I wanted to take the time to say thank you so much to all of you who make these town halls a possibility. And so with that, thank you so much everyone for coming tonight. And on behalf of Crystal Emery and the URU team, we hope that this was helpful. We thank you so much for joining us, whether this was your first time, whether you've been with us since the very beginning of our town halls. As always, we are very humbled to be able to serve the community. And we are gearing up to get ready for our summer programming. So this will be our last town hall for a little while, but please stay tuned. So you know what's going on. There's a lot of stuff in the works for URU. We're always here for you, for our community. Thank you all. We will keep you updated. And I hope you all have a wonderful evening. Namaskar.
Blessings.
Thank you so much. It was a pleasure and honor.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Carmen, we are still recording just in case. I don't know.
I was gonna say, I think we are still recording. Did we finish?